My goodness, have you ever taken a prescription where you felt like the benefits were not as bad as the side effects, or not as good as the side effects? Have you ever seen an advertisement for a prescription pill that actually looked like one of the side effects being possibly death, looked like a bad outcome? How often have we designed systems in our organizations where the side effects outweigh the benefits? Are you living under some systems right now that are driving the wrong results or even the wrong behavior? How many right now would say that right now we could get a lot better in what we're doing? Raise your hands if you would. Some of you are saying you're really good. That's awesome. I would really like to meet you. In fact, I have a bunch of examiners that would love to come and see you as well. But we're excited to be with you. I know some of you are nervous because you've said, where'd the house go? The principles remain the same, but the way we share and we bring this to life has just become clearer for us. We emphasize the principles because they do inform ideal behavior. And because of that, we can operationalize it. We would invite you today to be much more conscious about how we operationalize these things, and that we don't just come to a conference because it was a feel-good, but because it will make our jobs and our work and ultimately our results better. And that is our goal today. There was a recent survey done by the Center of Creative Leadership, and they asked this question. They said, what is one of the biggest causes of stress for leaders? What is one of the biggest causes of stress for leaders? The resounding answer was this. How many of you would agree? Having to do more with less and do it faster. Would you say that's probably true? Is it true that this is going to go away anytime soon? So we know this is reality for us. We know we have to do more with less most often. And more often than not, we're asked to do it quicker and better than anyone's ever done it before, and we're working a lot of hours to do it. So how do we create these kind of results? How do we do it over the long term? I would like to introduce you to someone who's been talked about a lot in the most recent weeks. How many are familiar and follow this company quite closely in terms of what they're doing operationally? Quite interesting, isn't it? Alan Mulally, of course, just announced that he'll be handing the reins over to Mark Fields. But prior to that happening, what happened to make such an incredible turnaround possible? Do you think it was just by accident or because they just had some crazy strategy sheet? For decades, they've had great ideas and plans. What made this one different? What made this one different? Bill Ford, let me suggest that he led with humility, following one of the principles which we espouse all the time, but how did he do that? Could you imagine being the CEO and heir to the throne and one of the proud principals and going to your board and saying, guess what, I cannot do this. I know I'm not capable of doing this on my own. And as a matter of fact, I need someone that can do this better than I can. Do you think he led with humility? He was looking for someone good. He went to someone else before, and as some of you might have read, he searched and searched and searched. It was quite a secret project. Only a few people knew that he was on this search. But when he finally found Alan Mulally, luckily he didn't choose one of the other people he was pursuing before that, because the other person had said, I want CEO and chairman, because quite frankly, I'm so good. I'm so good, you're gonna love me there. And so leading not with humility, he would have made a bad mistake, but he didn't. Alan Mulally came in and he said, you know what? I'll do it. And they said, well, gosh, are you sure? Because we'll give you the chairmanship as well if that's what it takes. And he said, no, that is not my job. My job is to come in and to be able to lead with a legacy that's been in place before me. And that's Bill Ford's job. That's his role. I will come in and I will do my best to do what I can. But I have to make sure that he's got my back. Prior to him coming in, though, Bill Ford actually had a famous meeting with his leaders when he said, we will continue to cut our costs and improve efficiency. At this time, no one had any idea how desperate they were. Bankruptcy? Absolutely. Most people actually thought that was imminent and almost guaranteed. But we cannot win the hearts and minds with efficiency alone. May I emphasize that for a moment? How many of us in our CI teams, or even in the work that you do currently, are completely viewed as the efficiency team? Is that what you do every day? Is your focus on the efficiency? What about when we call it leaning out the company? Man, I hate that term. I hate the fact that people have started to relegate improvement with efficiency gains that are leaning out the company, and that we dehumanize the workplace and we lose our hearts and minds as a result. That is not what we're about, and that is not the message that we share at the Shingo Prize. At the Shingo Institute, we emphasize that the way we get the results matters. And by following the principles, not only will we better achieve our results, but we will humanize the process at the same time. And that's what he was talking about. Later, he was still desperate, didn't know that Alan Mulally was still on the clock, or that he would, whether he would come or not. And he said this in January of 2006, "We will not stand for incremental change and avoiding risk and blocking innovation, defending procedures that don't make sense, and selling what we have instead of what the customer wants." This seems like common sense, but they were declaring it from on high, and "we will not stand for business as usual." Again, no one knew within Ford how desperate the situation really was. But when you ask people who worked there at the time, as I have, and some of you are in this audience today, they felt it, they knew it, and the tensions were huge. Only the tough survived at Ford. You'd get beat up if you weren't anything but mean and cruel. And the way we did things was backbiting. And we might have an executive session, but during that time, we're sending two or three emails making fun of the person speaking in front of us. And then only those who survived were the backhaul deals that were being made. The culture was so toxic that people hated being there. Sounds awesome, doesn't it? You ever been into an organization where after you walk out, you just feel like you need a shower? I was at a long-term healthcare facility once. I walked in and I felt like, holy cow, they're killing people here. And it's not because of the quality of care, but because of the way people are treated. May I suggest that we should no longer separate quality of care and bedside manner for those of us who are in healthcare. They are the same, and the same is that the way we treat people, not from just a bedside manner, but from the way we treat people in terms of quality, they are the same. The way we feel at work matters, and it matters big. But I digress, and I get passionate about this. He finally got Alan Mulally, and Alan said, "I will come in." And he goes, "Well, you can fire, you can hire, you can do whatever you want." Alan said, "No, I want to use the existing team." That's a different thing as well. How are you going to use the existing team? I don't think you can do it, because these guys, they know how to fight, and they will take you down. How many of us right now are dealing with a reality where every time you come in with a new idea, people just say, "You know what, that will only be about 2 months. We'll just keep our head down and we'll just move on. We're going to survive this. We're going to be fine." And we don't feel compelled to act on that vision because we're just going to survive it. Alan Mulally started to go like this. And well, in the book, if you've read the book American Icon, put it this way. Everything Mulally did seemed downright subversive in the industry that celebrated power and privilege. Detroit CEOs, are you kidding me? They don't dine with their employees, nor do they seem to care much about what the employees think. Quite an indictment on the way we treat people, isn't it? But isn't it true? You're lucky you have a job, as if that's supposed to be motivation anymore. People get tired of hearing that, right? Alan Mulally, he ate with people. He drove his own car. And by the way, it wasn't always an American car, which offended some of them. But he said, "If you don't understand the competition, how do you ever improve your own product?" It was the first time that they had ever forced someone to go buy someone else's fleet that was outside of America. In fact, they even bought a couple Toyotas, right? But they didn't want to talk about it publicly. Alan Mulally once brought his executive team together. He said, "Every week now we will meet together and you will be responsible for certain results." He was as clear as day, and some people challenged him on that. He said, "That's fine, you don't have to come anymore if you don't want." They understood what that meant. They came every week, and these were the numbers, by the way, that you will present. And by the way, because guess what? We're no longer Ford North America. We're no longer International Europe or Asia or some disparate location. We are one Ford. And he said, in order to get one Ford, we need to work together. So they started operationalizing this. They were in this meeting for like 45 minutes, just going crazy. How are we going to work together? How are we going to work together? And finally, Alan Mulally just gets up patiently after these 45 minutes and all these streams of data and who reports to who, and he just wrote on the board these two words: "Let's just work together." And all of a sudden, Mark Fields reports, according to the USA Today last week, Mark Fields reports, "Maybe we're just all making this a little bit too hard. maybe we're making this just a little bit too hard. I'm gonna ask you this question today. Would you share this with someone next to you? What are some things you're making too hard? We got like 2.5 minutes, please. What are some things you're making too hard? 32 seconds left, 32 seconds. I have to admit that today I might ask more questions than I have answers, but I hope that that'll at least provoke some new thought. As we lead in a new era of excellence, as Bob shared with us this morning, we need to be more purposeful, not just about efficiency, but specifically about excellence. If we want to get better results, we need to know where to focus. Companies that grow well and scale badly when they focus on running up the numbers but not the quality, well, they get bigger and they start to look like just any other organization. And there goes the value. Have we ever seen that? Not in your own company, of course, but you know, in someone else's, perhaps. I like this cartoon and how it captures this quite well. Today I broke the company record for the most parachutes packed in an hour. How would you feel jumping out of that plane? Yet we do it almost every day, right? What are we doing to achieve that? Scaling is not just about getting better or bigger. It is about getting better. How do we achieve that? We will not achieve it, and we will not succeed if we're not convinced that the way our people behave really, really matters. If your CI teams right now are pushing messages onto the floor without the team having any input in that, how is that helping to build the team? What kind of side effects are we creating that we didn't anticipate? We were working with a large company not so long ago, and we were traveling to this company that said, gosh, we were so frustrated. We'd go on the floor, we'd put a piece of tape down because it just made sense. But the operators, every time we came back, the tape would be gone. They were trying to create boundaries that the operators didn't make sense of, and they never thought to ask them, well, gosh, why that tape doesn't work for them. They just thought it made sense, and they kept putting it back. Can you imagine just the amount of time we spend doing things that don't make sense? He continues, Bob Sutton continues in this book, Scaling Up Excellence. Companies that scale well, they have sacred constraints, and they can never be screwed up. You cannot compromise on these things. To protect the brand, companies must spread not just a footprint. It's not just about grabbing geography, but also we must have a mindset, and that is the deeply ingrained beliefs and behaviors of our people. But how do we do that? How many of us feel like we should have got a psychology and counseling degree to do what we do instead of a MBA or whatever else you have? How many would agree that, gosh, I'm dealing with things I did not think I would have to deal with? May I submit that one of our greatest responsibilities as leaders comes from the way we interact with people? The interrelationships are so critical to success and have been so validated by too many people to ignore. We know by Daniel Goleman and many of his associates that have followed, who studied emotional intelligence, that 2/3 of our leadership success is determined by our ability to connect with others. Google wanted to find this out for themselves, because of course anyone else's data is just someone else's data. They put an algorithm together because they're very good at algorithms. And they qualitatively put together, they took 10,000 of their performance reviews, and then they did 400 qualitative interviews to find out what are the great characteristics of leadership at Google, and how do leaders succeed here, and why is it that we have certain groups that have very low turnover and always hit their deadlines? How do they do that? What makes them so good? And they had some hunches, some assumptions that were completely wrong. As a matter of fact, Laszlo Bock later lamented, their people development VP, we thought that the technical acumen, the IQ of our people, was paramount to our success. We found that that was dead last in terms of the most important characteristics. Of the most important characteristics, number one, knowing how to relate to my people in a sincere and genuine way. How do I relate to my people in a sincere and genuine way? I have been to many facilities where people said, we have a great culture here. And then they start to speak us and them. We have front of house, we have back of house. And when we go to the back of house, people hide. And I go, wow, that's interesting how you think this culture is so great for you. I would submit that we can all be better as we've raised our hands this morning and how this works. Kimpton Hotels put it this way, even with only 8,000 employees, we cannot afford the kind of corporate dehumanizing culture that squeezes the life out of many large companies. And yet, from the example we saw this morning with Ford Motor Company, a company that was willing to put their own logo on the line and put it out, as they call the small improvement home loan before the credit crisis occurred, to put it all on the line, to be willing to risk it all, and to have that phenomenal turnaround was only because they followed principles, principles that created a better behavior, and not because they supported systems and the status quo, right? We can't put lip service to this anymore. How has our focus on efficiency, standardization, and cost slowed, hampered, or squeezed the life out of our organization? Now, I'm not suggesting that these are bad things. Please do not think that, gosh, that Shingo group's just crazy. We'd get fired if we came in. But I would submit that we must challenge the status quo. Our focus simply on these things might start to dehumanize our workplace. And you will get side effects that you did not anticipate, and that you will get side effects that will hurt you for years and years to come. Not long ago in Copenhagen with our executive cohort, one of my colleagues and one of our attendees spoke eloquently about this and impacted me deeply when he said, "Max, I would not want to work for some of the companies that are getting so leaned out because they don't elevate or celebrate the human being anymore, and they have forgotten where they started." How many of you would agree that being in a dehumanized workplace just isn't any fun either? Yeah. The side effects are too great, and we must be more conscious and more aware of them. May I suggest that if you have an organization right now that is pressing you and pushing you towards these things at all costs, regardless of any other outcome, that you should push back and submit that maybe our focus should be more on excellence and not just efficiency? How many of you would agree that culture, every behavior of every employee, is critical to your success? By a show of hands, I really do care. Would you agree? So it's important to us, right? And we understand it. For decades, lots of companies have talked about it. And culture is key. Doug Conant from CEO of Campbell Soup said the same thing. But he got into an environment where their supply chain was in a bad shape. In 2002, their engagement surveys were quite bad. Doug Conant came into a workplace where their high performers were turning over frequently. They didn't want to stay there for very long. By 2012, when he left, he said, or not only did they have high engagement scores, according to the Gallup organization, who measured it every single year for them, but they retained their high performers. Isn't it interesting that it's usually the high performers who can leave the quickest? How do you retain and maintain the hearts and minds if we're not humanizing the workplace with a focus and an intention and a strict focus on how to make the workplace better? The culture is king in creating that. In a recent survey by Inc. magazine, they wanted to find out what mid-sized companies are doing to grow. They looked at 100,000 mid-sized companies, and then they asked, how many of them had added headcount over the last 5 years? Only 1,500 had out of 100,000. 1%, 1.5% to be specific, had actually discovered or been able to grow. Out of that 1,500, they wanted to find out, what was it about these companies that enabled them to grow despite the fact that we've had huge financial challenges? These two factors that I've posted here are the underlying factors, they said, that were bar none the most important factors for any company to succeed. Could the writing on the wall be any clearer for us today? Could we have any more of a mission than we have today? We must humanize the workplaces we work in, and we must help people understand that the CI team is not here just to take people out, but to build them up. We are here to make lives better, not worse. And while we do live under stress and we have more to do today than we'll ever be able to continue in a lifetime, we have a bigger mandate than we've all talked about in the past. Culture is ultimately about the relationship. Stephen Covey summarized it this way: a cardinal principle of total quality escapes too many managers. You can't continuously improve independent of systems and processes until you progressively perfect interdependent and interpersonal relationships. We can talk systems, and I'm not saying that systems aren't important because they are key to our success, but how I design that system is so much more important. And that's the ad hocness that we talked about and how Bob referred to earlier as well. The systems must be designed with an intention and a purpose behind them that reinforces the focus and not just the value statements on the wall. Many failed companies have had some really good declarations on the wall. But that doesn't make it so. The best companies, according to Gallup, we found that the top 25% of the best managed companies versus the bottom 25%. Well, the best top 25%, they have fewer defects, they have higher quality, and oh, by the way, their healthcare costs are lower. They have less absenteeism, and the statistics prove on and on why this is so important. Gallup summarized it this way: the single biggest decision we will make in our job, bigger than any of the rest, is who we will name our managers. When you name the wrong person as manager, nothing fixes that bad decision. Not compensation, not benefits, nothing. If you have high turnover happening in your organization and it's happening in a particular department, well, you know who that group is. And by the way, do you think our employees know who the bad managers are? Come on, if we don't think that, we're fooling ourselves. They know who the bad people are, and typically who do they go to? They go to HR and they say, listen, I want to stay at this organization, but please don't make me work in that department anymore. Because that person's not good for my future or for my current health. I don't want to be a part of this anymore if that's what I have to live with. See, because life is short, and I got something bigger. See, we say people are our most important asset. No, you're not. Your chair's an asset. You're an expense, pal. Let's just tell it how it is. Let's not allow the hypocrisy to reign in our organizations anymore. How many believe that the culture where you currently work could be better? We talked about it a moment ago, so I leave that question with you as a rhetorical. But I will sum this piece up today with this. We cannot manage those who are not here today. We might be able to influence them later on. But for today, the only answer we can really answer is how and what is it like to work for me as an individual? What is it like to work with you? How do people feel after working with you? What is it like to be with you? Daniel Goleman said it this way: the more we act a certain way, whether we're happy or whether we're depressed or cranky, the more the behavior becomes ingrained in our brain circuitry, and the more we will continue to feel and act that way. If you come to work every day and you're just angry, would you please just find some place where you don't influence a lot of other people? Because it hurts the business. It literally hurts the business if every day you just come to work angry. And I would hope that if you have angry people and you don't know what to do with them, you find a job where they can work in their corner and not have to impact everyone else. Because angry people don't do us any favors. That virus of that emotion spreads, and it spreads faster than an illness. It spreads faster than the cold. And if you have angry people coming to work all the time, that anger will create resentment and the brain circuitry will be reduced. So with my kids, when I am at home, when we tuck them in at bed at night, despite the fact that there might have been some good things and some bad things that occurred throughout the day, including maybe a timeout because, you know, he might have hit his sister. But, you know, it's how they grow up. But when I ask them, when I tuck them in bed at night, I ask my son and I ask my daughter, I say, what was the best part of your day today? What was the greatest thing you did today? And as they identify that one good thing, I want them rewiring their brain circuitry to look for the good. Because the more positive we are, the more happy we are, the better and the more likely we are to be successful and to be able to produce better results. We know in doctors, in healthcare, that happy doctors make a faster and a more accurate diagnosis. Think about that for a moment if you were in the operating room. Did you know that an angry doctor produces worse outcomes? Did you know that most on-site infections, well, not most, that would be too big for me to prove statistically, but many on-site infections and patient outcomes are deeply and directly impacted by the morale of those who are operating on you? Think about that the next time you have to go. If you're unconscious, you might want to have it tattooed on your body. Take me to a happy doctor. Because I know they might be more likely to save my life. It's absolutely true. I've walked through some of these hospitals. I've had scrubs on when I did it. We were in one yesterday, a fantastic organization. Can we all get better? Yeah, absolutely. I was walking through an organization one day, and the hospital, a surgeon, chief attendant, came out. He had just operated on a cancer patient. I was standing next to the executive who was taking me through this tour, and the person said, "I hate working here." This is the surgeon. She's trying to calm him down. He goes, "No, I really hate working here. Like, we didn't get it." She goes, "You know what? I know that, and so does everyone else." No. The way we treat each other is so important. I talked to an anesthesiologist who came out of the same room. He was pretty dejected. And he goes, "You know what's really frustrating is when I have to focus more on the dynamics of the room than I do on the patient." This reality is true. If we know it can be life and death, we know it can impact our organizations today just as quickly. We cannot take this as our work survival strategy. This is no longer acceptable. This is no longer acceptable if you want to have excellence. We are tired of the status quo. It is time to go bigger. Harvard put it this way: most leaders today emphasize the strength in their competence, their credentials. But that is exactly the wrong approach. Leaders who project strength before establishing trust run the risk of eliciting fear, and along with that, a host of dysfunctional behaviors. Why are we so frustrated when every time we come to work, it's not working for us? Why does this matter? Does it really cost us much money? We have an interesting piece of research done by Christine Porath, who wanted to know that. She said, "What is it like if we just send one bad email? How much does that cost our organization? How much does it cost if someone just gets that one?" You ever received that bad email? Not in your current organization, but you know, in your previous organization, you ever received a bad email? That one that you go, "Oh my gosh, I just don't know if I can do this anymore." You ever had that one? I know it's not good to raise your hand because your boss is sitting next to you. That's fine. That's fine. I don't want you to get in trouble today, but it's interesting. I was in Toronto not long ago when a young woman came to me. She goes, "Look at this email I just got from my boss." Unfortunately, I read too many of these emails, I have to say. She showed me this email that said, "You will never go to another conference again. You look at how much work you've given me since you left." This was day one of a 3-day conference, by the way. From now on out, she is networking on the company's dime. Right? How much does this cost? According to Christine Porath, Georgetown professor at the time she was at Stanford, when she wrote and published this work, how much does it cost? Does it cost us $15,000 every time we get a bad email? A $1,500? $150? Or $1.30? Well, because you don't want to bid over. How many would say it's $15,000 every time we get one of those bad emails? No one in the room. Oh, we got one or two. $1,500. How many for $1,500? This is polling the audience, see? So if we were to call a friend, you're the friend. Please be good. $1,500, okay, and $150. $150, a few, and how for $1.30? Because you just don't want to bid over, right? And that's another generation I appreciate. It was $1,500. $1,500 every time we mistreat an employee. Let's extrapolate that. In a healthcare system, they suggest that in a $1 billion revenue system, we mistreat each other to the tune of $71 million a year. And that's just in the mistrust. That doesn't include the operation of the patient costs. That's just in mistreating each other. In your could do, should do, and haven't done meeting, you know that meeting you do every week that really pumps people up, and then you say, "Now, go smile," because that's what we do. And you tell everyone to perform at a higher level. And have you ever reported, "Hey, this week we mistreated each other to the tune of like 25 grand. Have you ever reported this number? Isn't it interesting how we can focus on so many things and push people down, but these numbers just don't get talked about? We all need help in this. This is my daughter. None of us are immune. We will all make mistakes. You can tell she definitely has my gene pool. Of course, we adopted our daughter from Hunan, China in 2009. Prior to that, I had lived in Shanghai for a number of years. My daughter in 2009, when we went to pick her up, though, she was 2.5 years old. She was a survivor of an orphanage that, well, frankly, as you can imagine, isn't the best of conditions. At 2.5 years old, she was very effective at a couple things. One of them was hitting. Her only brother at the time, who was 10 months old, wasn't too fond of this new skill. And he's like, "Who invited her?" Right? But she was quite capable of it. We thought, gosh, how do we change this behavior? What are we going to do? So we started complimenting her when she did the right thing. "Thank you for putting your shoes on right. Thanks for not attacking your brother. Thanks for listening to your mom." And one day I made a promise to her. I said, "Honey, today we're just going to play," because I travel quite a bit. "Today we're just going to play. That's what we're gonna do. Have you ever made a promise to someone and then started doing something else? Please tell me I'm not the only one, because that's very, very good, thank you. I made a promise to my daughter, and if she wasn't such a bulldog, I'm afraid that I would not be able to report this story today. She comes up to me, she goes, Dad, you said today we were gonna play. Of course, I was busily engaged. I had many important things to do. And certainly they were important. But my daughter comes up to me, she goes, Dad, you said today we were gonna play. Would you please put that away? Yeah, honey, yeah, yeah. Now, if she would have just walked away at that point, I'm afraid to admit what I would have done. Because I know I would have continued to work. But instead, she gets in my lap. Dad, you said we were gonna play, and I'm working around her. And I got my work around, and finally she goes, Dad, would you please put that away? And I put it away, and she said, Dad, thanks for listening. Folks, we will all be guilty of making these mistakes. None of us are immune. May I submit that if you think it's only someone else's problem, today you have deceived yourself. And that we must reveal where we're at and how we show up on a more frequent basis. Bottom line, those who prioritize warmth and connect with their people will make a bigger difference. How do people feel after spending time with you? How do people feel after spending time with you? Sean Aker summarized it this way, and this is a book, by the way, that I highly recommend. I wish I got a commission on it because I recommend it that highly. But he said it this way, we all know that we should exercise and sleep 8 hours and eat healthier and be kind to others. Shoot, we've grown up living this, right? But does this common knowledge make these things any easier? Of course not. Because in life, knowledge is only part of the battle. Without action, knowledge is meaningless. We have a lot of people who are knowledgeable, but quite frankly, don't do a whole lot for us. The question is, how are you going to put what you learned this week, as Bob so eloquently invited us to do, how will you take what you learned this week and put it into action and do something about this today? The Shingo model is a powerful tool for identifying ideal behaviors. And the way we do that is by understanding the principles with deep clarity. And that's what we do with our cohorts. That's what we do in our education. And for those of you who experienced our Discover Excellence course from some of our licensed affiliates, was that a fantastic experience? Did you enjoy it? Was it okay that you didn't see the house? I hope you're okay. We emphasize the principles because the emphasis is around clarity around that principle. And the better I understand it, the better I can identify ideal behavior. The better I understand ideal behavior, the better I can design systems that complement human behavior. And now I'm not just checking the wind to see which way the wind blows before I put another policy or procedure in place. But I create an impact that means something bigger. And that's the invitation. I will summarize and finish. Lin Hao was a young man in China in 2008 where the earthquake occurred. You might recall that there were 50,000 people who died in that earthquake. He was in a school building and he was only 8 years old at the time. When he got out of the rubble, he was trying to figure out what in the world just happened to my life. Instead of running home, which many eight-year-olds would probably likely do to just tell me something's normal, Lin Hao started going back in the rubble and pulling kids out. And then when he realized there were kids, he couldn't get out of the rubble on his own. He went back in the rubble and sang to them. For hours and hours and hours, he sang to them. And when they asked him, why did you do this? He simply said, I was the hall monitor. Leaders, do you know your purpose? Have you taken the knowledge that you have and put it into action? Because that's what this is about. We do not need hypocrisy. We do not need high proclamations from on high. We're tired of that. And frankly, as Doug Conant put it so well, he said, people are tired of the BS in PR. Aren't we really tired of it? Let's be different. Let's live it different. Aristotle invited us to think differently. To be excellent, we cannot simply think or feel excellent. We must act excellently. What will you do today to act more excellently? What will you do as a result of this conference to be more excellent? And let us lead instead of follow where we're going in creating a culture that means something for our organizations. Thank you for being here. We're grateful you're here, and we're grateful that we're part of this. Thank you.